good evening. Thank you for coming back. We pray that you have a good week, and we ask that you do remember those on the prayer list, those that are sick and shut in. Much to pray about, so let's continue to remember all those that we have on our prayer list. Is there any others that we need to add that we may be unaware of at this time? All right. By the way of announcements, remember the seniors will be eating at Mud Creek over in Hollywood. You'll be leaving here at 11 o'clock if you'd like to ride the bus. And promptly, 11 o'clock. And we know that we always have a good time over there. I've missed the last two or three, so maybe Miss Marcia's feeling sorry for me and going to have us a restaurant close to the house. So that may be why we're going to Mud Creek. So we try our very best to be there. But you do pray for us. And remember us this week. Do always pray for us. God give us direction in what we preach and what we bring to you every week. So do continue to pray for us and our family. Continue to remember one of ours and with his shots and his allergies and things. Maybe that'll wind down pretty quickly, but do continue to remember that need. And we ask that you do remember the 4th of October will be the last day. We need to get our Haiti bags back if we can, and we get all those accounted for. So we'll try to get those and get Brother Lamar by here and gather those up and get those to Haiti. And do remember, I believe October the 4th, we're going to try to have, you'll have to remind me, my mind went blank. Who's coming the 4th? Mr. Doolittle will be here. Brother Stephen Doolittle, his family, be passing through this area on their way to Scottsboro. So he'll be here to give us an update on the ministry and everything he's doing down there. So do remember that service coming up. And there'll be a lot up on us here. And next, it's almost Christmas time already, so I'm telling time is flying. So do remember all the needs, upcoming events. Anything else, any other announcements? Just come to my mind, Miss Joyce will be having surgery on her hand tomorrow, so do remember her. If nothing else, we'd ask our men to come forward. Our young men would take up our evening offering.
Yeah.
right, if you have your Bible this afternoon, turn with us to 1 Kings 17.
1 Kings 17, we'd like to read a few verses this afternoon. We pray that this will be a help to you. We feel this is where God has directed us for this evening. And this is one of those passages of Scripture that's harder lived than preached. But yet we want to really walk away from this passage of Scripture knowing that we can put our trust and our faith in a God that can, and that God is in He's in control of our life, and that's where our peace and our comfort comes from. But if you have 1 Kings 17, we just want to read just a few verses here. Let's read through verse 7. So stand with us, we'll read, and then we'll pray, and then we'll just dive right into this passage of Scripture. Try not to tarry long, but to really just give you what God's laid upon our heart. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass, after a while, the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you today for the word of God. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for each and every song. God, we thank you for the opportunity. Now we pray you'd just touch our heart and our lives. God, I pray you'd use us, God, in the life of these that are gathered here. God, to encourage them, to help them, to reassure their heart, their life. God, that we have a God that is in heaven, that is in control. And God, nothing has caught you off guard. Father, we pray now that you just take us, use us, help us for the next few moments. God, we give you honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Been thinking about a lot lately about some things that you'll never hear anyone say to God. I don't think we can ever imagine that anyone could go to God and say surprise, because he is aware of all things. God knows. God is aware. Yet we see that God is really doing something in the life of his prophet Elijah. And we have to relate with the Word of God. We understand that what God is doing in the life of Elijah is also something that He will do in our life as well. You say, what do you mean? Well, God always uses a desert place in the life of the Christian to transform him. And that is what God is doing in Elijah's life here. We know that God is going to use him mightily. You know, we read these stories, and yet there are really stories that should encourage our heart, but to really bring to reality that there is always a place in life that it seems dry. There's always a place in life that is not very comfortable. There are places in life, and if you're not there, you will be there. Once you're saved, God uses this this time of transformation to help us to grow our faith. Really, as we see in just a few moments, that really Elijah really has to take God at his word. And believing upon the power and the provisions of God, God is going to prove himself to Elijah, because Elijah has much work to do. And you know, God always uses a desert place in the life or in the molding of his disciples. Moses was on the backside of the desert. We remember Joseph was in the prison. We could say Paul in the desert of Arabia. So God always uses a place in our life that we can focus on him. And that's what we're going to see this afternoon. There's really two things that I believe from this passage. And this passage, you know, this is something that we could preach every service and get something different from. But there's just really two things we want to focus on this afternoon, because if you're not there, you will be there. If you're there, This is to encourage you. And if you're not there, you've been there, you're going to go back there. It is a series, or there is a process in the Christian life. Christians must exercise their faith. When troubles or when trials come into our life, the validity is that God really proves Himself and is really going to provide for His children. God doesn't send you to that place. Well, let's just think about this place. Really, the first thing I want to focus on this afternoon is the location. What does it say about this location? What does it say about this place? This is a physical place, but yet we can really come along beside of this passage, and we can compare that not just to a physical place, but to a spiritual place where we might be in our hearts. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, "Get thee hence and turn thee eastward." And the Bible said, I want you to hide thyself. The location here is a place of hiding. When I read this, it tells me that it is a private place. It is a place that God has taken this prophet. He has taken Elijah into the very presence of the king. We know that Ahab and his wicked wife, we know that they are wicked to the core. And God is going to really use Elijah to predict the weather for the next 3.5 years. We know there's going to be a contest. He is going to go against the prophets of Baal. And there are many things that God is going to do in his life to prepare him for that. So let me say, if you're in this private place tonight, this location in your heart where you might be, let me say God has directed you there. We may not always, if we had our choice, we'd never go to the brook Cherith. Not me. If God gave me a choice, I want you to go to the brook Cherith. Or I want to take you to a place that that there's going to be servants and food. You know, it's going to be a place of abundance, a place of ease, a place of rest. We never learn that we can depend on God. That's where we learn that we depend on God, at the brook Cherith. It is not a place that we want to volunteer to go, but is it a place that is designated by God for Him to get there? There is where your blessing is going to be. There is where I'm going to provide for you. I want you to get there at this place, and it is a private place. Why do you think so? Why do you think sometimes God takes us into a place of loneliness? A place of despair. I mean, there's no one there. You know, while He's there, I believe He has time or opportunity to really reflect on His blessings and the life that God has given Him. And it is a place that when, you know, God has to get us to a place, really, to shut out the noise of life where we really can focus and hear His voice. Right? So, you know, when everything's going good, we don't really listen to the voice of God. But when we get to the brook Cherith, when we get to a private location in our heart, in our life, we really, it seems that, you know, the voice of God is amplified in the quietness of our life. When we're lonely, when we're in a private place, and the Bible tells us to be still at times. A lot of times when we're worried, we're active. You know, we're just as confused as a termite in a yo-yo sometime. We're darting around. I mean, we're worried about this and worried about that. But what God wants us to do is just be still, that you can hear His voice. It's a location of privacy. It talks about loneliness. There's no one there. He's there by Himself, but He is at a place, I believe, that when God speaks, it's going to be clear. And we know that it is, because when the brook dried up, in verse 8 it said, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, and the word of the Lord directed him along this series of paths, the series of light that God has given him. God is directing your life and my life. We're not here tonight in the month of September in 2015 by chance. We have been directed through our life. We look back over our life, don't we? We see how that God has had a hand in bringing us here tonight. And there are times in life when God wants to grow our faith that He takes us to the brook Cherith. Let me say, it's not always a comfortable place. It's not always an easy place. It's not always a place that we'd volunteer to go. But let me say that it is a place of necessity. It is a place that God uses in His design. It's a private place. But not only is it private, He said, I want you to hide yourself by the brook Cherith that is beyond Jordan. Not only is it a private place, but the idea here is that it is a painful place. Cherith has the idea of cutting away something. And I believe that if you're going to be used by God, and God has a desire for all of us to be used, sometimes God has to cut things away from our life, does He not? And we'll end our sermon with maybe some things that God had maybe performed in the life of Elijah here. But yet, God wants to cut things out of our life that are not necessary. You know, there are a lot of things that we're holding on to that we feel that are necessary for life, but only if we just give those things up, God could put in our hands something greater. Right? You know, my pastor, his wife, you know, she always said, God will never take nothing away from you that'll not give you something 10 times better. And that is true in a sense that, you know, there are a lot of things that God really wants to cut out of our life we think that is necessary. But really, if we let go of those things, God can replace those things with better things. There are a lot of things I thought I needed in life that I had to get to the brook Cherith where God could cut those things away. And yet, because God could cut those things away and get those things out of our life, there was room that we could grow. There's a pruning in the Christian life, and that talks of pain, does it not? To produce more fruit, sometimes God has to prune back the vines. Those little, you know, we've preached on that in the past. Sometimes there's those things called sucker vines on a fruit vine. They don't produce fruit, but they take the nutrients away from the vines that do produce fruit. And, you know, God has to take, you know, in my life, that's been the case. There have been times there have been some sucker vines to sprout in my life that would take away the nutrients from the things that matter. And it takes it away from those things that matter and that grow the vine that doesn't produce fruit. So what does the master of the vineyard do? He comes by and he clips those things off. Why? Where the nutrients can return and go to the vines that are producing fruit. Am I making sense? That happens at the place called Cherith. It's not an easy place to be. It's a painful place, is it not? It's not a place that we would desire to be. But let me say, not only is Cherith, not only is it painful, but yet it is purposeful, right? There is a purpose. What we have to understand, what does Peter ask us to do? He wants us to submit to the authority of God. Now, in my life, sometimes when I'm at Cherith, I complain. God, I don't like it here. Lord, you know, sometimes does the devil not show up and say, you serve God, you live for God, and this happens? You know, it is a place not only pain, but it's a place of purpose. What we have to designate in our heart is that God is transforming our life for His purpose, for His glory. And when we submit to Him and say, God, I am aware You're in control of my life, I give it unto You, then I believe grace can minister to our heart and we can overflow with joy knowing God's in control. Didn't I say this is easier preached than lived? There are times in life that it's not easy, but there are also times where God takes us to this location called Cherith. Not an easy place. Not a place we'd want to be. But it is a place of necessity at times in the Christian life. And he said in verse 4, and it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. Blessing is always, always followed by obedience. He knew what to do. It was time that he get to that place that God had designated. And now he is there. And the Bible says the ravens brought to him bread and flesh in the morning. And the ravens brought bread and flesh in the evening. And he drank of the brook until the brook went dry. Why do you think God took him to that location? Our last point is this. I believe it was for a lesson. It was for a purpose. What do you think he learned there at the brook Cherith? I don't know. This afternoon, as I begin to think about this passage of Scripture, there's really just three things that I believe God wanted to show him. What he showed me in this passage of Scripture. First, let's look at the brook. He took him there. There we understand it must have been either a wet weather spring or maybe some type of spring that maybe didn't flow all the time. We know that it did go dry, but whether it was there and because there was a lack of rain, the Bible said the brook dried up. And understanding that this brook, the water was the resources that really provided for his sustenance, for his life. He needed water. And yet the raven came and it dropped and gave him bread and it gave him flesh in the morning and in the evening. What are you saying? I'm saying when you are at that place, Cherith, it's not a comfortable place. It's not a place we desire to be, but it is a place of necessity. It is a place designed by God. And beforehand, God has always or already designated how that he is going to be sustained. And it's by the brook. It's by the bird. And I understand this, that this brook, it gave life-giving water. The bird gave life-giving food, sustenance that would sustain him. Let me say this, if you're at the brook Cherith, God's going to take care of you. It may be in the unlikeliest of sorts, but God will provide for your necessity. God will care for you. God hasn't placed you there just simply to be mean. He has given you that place. There is opportunity to grow and to understand your dependence upon God and how that God is going to perform this task in your life. God may be getting ready to do something greater in your life through this tragedy. God may be able to do something greater in your life because you're at this place, Cherith, right now. Yet God can do, and we'll understand as we read on, yet God is going to really open doors. God closes a door here in just a few moments when the brook dries up. But yet God is already there. When one door closes, God has already opened another door. And he's going to send him to a widow woman down in Zarephath. And her son, she's a widow woman, and her son dies. Do you see that God may be opening doors, closing doors, opening doors to get you into a place that you can be? And what does Elijah do? Elijah goes into him, and he lays upon him, and three times he asks God to restore the soul of that young man, and he brings back life. What are you saying? I'm saying God may be doing something at Cherith to get you to Zarephath, where you might be a blessing to somebody else one day. I don't know what God may be doing in your life or in my life, but I have to do know this. God is doing something in our life. We're not just floating around like a balloon full of helium carried about with the wind, are we? No, God is directing our path. God has a purpose in what he does. But yet there are some lessons that we need to be aware of about the brook. Elijah's life was never sustained simply by the water. It was never sustained simply by the bird. It was sustained by God himself. What he needs to be aware of, what is the lesson that I believe God is showing Elijah here is that all of your blessings arrive from me. Right? Now we need to learn, and we spoke about that maybe Wednesday night or maybe last Sunday. It has been just a few services back. We need to be aware that our blessing is not in our paycheck. We know where our paycheck comes from. It derives from God. We need to understand that all of our blessings, they come from God. Everything that is good, the Bible said, comes down from the Father of Light in the book of James. We know that they arrive from God. I believe that God wants us to understand that lesson. Our healing is not in medicine. Our healing is not in the doctor. Our healing is in the great physician, is it not? Our life, our sustenance is in the hand of God. You know, our breath, the Bible says, in his hand. Every breath is accounted for. Every heartbeat is accounted for. Every hair is accounted for. We can trust God at the brook Cherith, can we not? There are some lessons that we need to learn. And I believe he is getting to the place that he can believe God. We said here that faith is believing God when we don't have all the pieces to the puzzle. We take God simply at His word. God said, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to take care of you. God said, I'm going to take care not just of Elijah. I'm going to take care of you. All of us, God is going to take care of. But what I believe that we need to learn here, what do you think that He's doing? I take a lesson away from this brook. You think about the brook. A brook without water is nothing. The brook, I believe if Elijah were to look back over his life, he could say, you know, I'm just like that brook. I'm of a benefit to no one without life-giving water. And that's what God really wants us to understand. Without Him, we can do nothing. God simply wants us to be the channel. He wants us to be a brook in which He can flow water through the life or through our efforts to benefit those around us. You know, you think about these things, there's a difference between a river and a reservoir, right? The Christian life, we have enough reservoirs. You know, you just fill it up and when it's full, it doesn't go anywhere. God doesn't want us really just to hold our blessing. God wants us to be a channel or a river of blessings. He wants to really flow through our lives, that we flow into the lives of others, right? And how does He do that? He takes us to the brook Cherith. He lets us understand without water, without life-giving water, Jesus Christ is the water that is living in our life. Without that, we're nothing, right? Without Him, where would we be? Without Him, there is no life-giving substance in us. You know, sometimes we're like that brook, and God wants to use us like the brook. But God wants to use us like the raven. You see, this bird is an unclean bird. According to Levitical law, he eats dead things. I mean, he's unclean. But yet, Elijah could understand from the bird. Elijah was sustained in his life by the brook and by this bird. And I realize that, you know, sometimes I can relate like that. Sometimes we have to see our... If you're going to be used by God, you have to be aware that it is God that is using you. You have to be aware of where your blessings arrive. Realize here that he goes, and I believe he can relate with that, and we relate with that. You know, God can take an unclean animal, and he can bring life-giving substance to his people through this unclean animal every morning and every night. What are you saying? It's amazing to me that God wants to use us like the brook. He wants water to flow through our life to be a blessing to someone else. He wants us to be like this bird, this unclean animal. But yet, when God really designates this raven to fly out where, you know, maybe, as one commentator said, maybe this bird flies into Ahab and Jezebel's table and takes away some things from them and gives them to Elijah. I don't know where the food arrived or where it came from, but all I know is every morning and every evening that Elijah could depend upon this raven to give him life-giving food. And God wants to use us like the brook and like the raven. God can use an unclean animal to give life. How did he bring that? I don't know, maybe it was with his food, with his feet, or with his beak. I don't know how that he brought it, but yet God wants to use us to bring life to those around us, and God can use the unlikeliest of sorts. He can use the sinners of this world to convey a message to the lost and dying world. God wants to use you. God wants you to be aware. There are some lessons I believe that he learned. Without God, I can do nothing. But with God, we can do all things. With Jesus Christ, the Bible said all things are possible, right? All things are possible. And yet when we go to the brook, there are some lessons that we need to learn. What are the blessings? Well, I'm going to give you just three things that I begin to think about. Elijah's resources were depleted, but yet God opened another door. You know, all these things God is doing in Elijah's life. The resources, when they are depleted. You know, Elijah needed to learn that the dependency was not upon himself, but upon God. We don't trust in ourselves. We lean not to our own understanding. When you lean on your own understanding, you're apt to fall. But when we lean upon the mighty hand and the strong arm of God, Psalms 46 said He is a present help in time of trouble. The Bible said He is a refuge we can run to. He is a place that we can carry our burdens. Yet we need to learn that our dependency is not upon self. Those are things I believe that God wants to cut out of our lives when we place our confidence in ourselves. But yet what I understand is God is going to develop Elijah into a great man of God. God sends us to the brook Cherith that He might develop our faith and our confidence in God. God wants you to understand, I've got this in my hand. And every now and then, I can even send an unclean bird your way to bring you life-giving food. How God uses a preacher, how God uses any of us, really, to give life-giving substance to the soul of humanity. God wants to use you. God uses you mightily when we graduate from the school of Cherith. It's not a place that we want to graduate. But all of us that have been there, we can attest to the fact that it wasn't ourselves. It wasn't anything within us. We're like the brook. Without water, we're useless. We're like the raven. We're unclean, but God uses the things that we call unclean to give life to those that are around Him. Yet, I believe God develops our faith. God may be developing our faith this afternoon. And let me tell you, it's not an easy place to be. If you're not there, one day you're going to look back and say, He told us we'd go there. But if you are there, let me give you some encouragement. When you graduate, you go back. It is a series of stepping out on faith. What do you do? Well, He says, so he went and did according to the word of the Lord. And he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. Not an easy place, is it, to be. But let me tell you, if you're where you're supposed to be, you may feel that it's unfair. You may feel in your heart that it's not right. But you have to be aware of this, that God has designated you to be there. And if you're there, if you're where God wants you to be, this place that's private, this place that is painful, but that there is a place that it is purposeful. And I close. If He's got you there, He's going to sustain you there. You can leave, but there's no guarantee He'll sustain you. But if you're there and you accept, I'm here for a time, just for a time, for a season, let patience have her perfect work, James says, that it may produce something in our life. You know, we can read about faith, but until we live it, we can't talk about faith, can we? We can read about the heroes of faith. We can read about it in our Bible. You know, we could read Warren Wiersbe's book, Walking with the Giants, where he talks about many that have come before us and have gone on to be with the Lord. I mean, we could talk about how God did great things in their life, but yet there's evidence when you go to the brook of Cherith, you can say without doubt, God will do what He says. God will not fail one word of His blessed promise. But when we are aware that God has designated this place in our life, we wait there. And when God moves, God will provide. But let me tell you that God will, when the brook dries up, He'll open up a door of opportunity that we respond by faith again and again. But every step along the way, you'll get stronger. Your confidence, could you imagine? Maybe Elijah there on the mountain before all this transpires. Maybe he's lacking in his confidence. Maybe he's there with doubt and fear in his life, praying for rain. He doesn't know if it's going to come. But I believe through all these series of tests and growth, when he gets to Mount Carmel, when he gets to where there's going to be a showdown, When he begins to pray for rain, when there's doubt and fears in every other life there, when they come back and say, Elijah, there's no rain, he said, you can go look again. He never gave up, and the Bible said he prayed again. You know, how did that happen? I believe that happened because it all began at this place called Cherith. It's not easy when God wants to cut things out of our life. You know, it's often time. And I'll close. Brother Robert, come get us a verse of song. Really, there are times in our life when we're at the brook Cherith. When we're there, and only there, I have found out that is where I really find out what really matters in life. When everything's going well, when everything's going good, I think that there are other things that are more important. But you find out at the brook Cherith, you find out what family's all about. You find out what friends are all about. You find out what your relationship with the Lord is all about. And really, what else matters, right? Things in life really don't take precedence over your relationship with God. And you find out there. It's amazing to me that God pours out His grace upon us when we need it most. God never fails, does He, in His grace. I'm saying if you're at the brook Cherith tonight, I pray maybe this little old raven came by to give you a little food. And just like the raven, when we get through with this valley, we can look back and say, God wants to use me like the brook and like the bird. Well, a first-hand experience, Elijah could say, he sent it every day, every morning, every evening. The relationship with God that he had there, I believe when God spoke unto him, it was clear. There was no confusion. He knew exactly what to do. God may have you there that you can focus solely upon what really matters in life. Brother Robert, 303, would you stand?